Welcome to our Mystery Sleep Stories channel, your sanctuary for meditation and a peaceful sleep. Immerse yourself in the soothing embrace of sleep-inducing tales, carefully crafted to transport you to mysterious lands. Let the gentle rain and serene sounds of nature accompany you on this quest for deep sleep. Say goodbye to restless nights and welcome the embrace of a restful sleep with our mystery bedtime stories. So, let the tale begin. The Cursed Crown, Escape from Byzantium. Chapter 1, The Theft in Byzantium. In the heart of ancient Byzantium, under a moon veiled by the whispers of conspiring clouds, Iason, a notorious thief whose name was murmured with both fear and awe throughout the underground, readied himself for the greatest heist of his career. His target was nothing less than the sacred repository, a vault nestled within the depths of a fortified monastery, housing relics of immeasurable value and mystical power. The monastery, a sprawling complex of shadowed cloisters and silent, echoing halls, was guarded not only by walls of imposing stone, but by the ceaseless vigil of the devout, monks who believed they were protecting sacred gifts bestowed by the divine. Among these holy treasures was the diadem, rumored to be forged from the fangs of a serpent blessed by ancient gods and cursed by saints long dead, its powers shrouded in mystery and darkness. Iason approached the monastery, cloaked not only in the darkness of the night, but in the guise of a pilgrim seeking sanctuary. His disguise was meticulous, his manner pious, allowing him to slip past the outer gates with little more than a nod from the gatekeeper. Inside, the air was thick with incense and the murmur of prayers, a solemn atmosphere that masked the tension tightening in Iason's chest. He moved with purpose, guided by the map he had painstakingly assembled from fragments of lore and stolen glances at forbidden texts. Each step through the dimly lit corridors brought him closer to the inner sanctum, where the relics were kept under lock and key, guarded by an ancient order sworn to protect them until the end of days. The inner sanctum was a vaulted chamber, its walls adorned with mosaics depicting scenes of celestial battles and divine pacts. The air inside was cool and still, as if the very room were holding its breath. At the center, illuminated by the flickering light of a single hanging oil lamp, stood the sacred repository, a heavy, iron-bound chest engraved with sigils that hummed with a faint, eerie energy. Iason's fingers twitched in anticipation as he approached the chest. He had studied these locks and traps, had practiced their mechanisms on replicas crafted in the dark corners of his hideout. His tools, slender and precise, slid from the folds of his robe, dancing in his skilled hands as he set to work. The lock gave way with a soft click that echoed like a shout in the silent room. As he lifted the lid, the air grew thick with power. The diadem lay on a bed of ancient velvet, its silver glinting with a light that seemed to pulse with life. The serpentine design was exquisite, the fangs intricately carved to convey both beauty and menace. As Iason wrapped his fingers around it, a chill shot through his body. A warning or a portent, he could not tell. At that moment, the distant clang of alarm bells shattered the stillness. Iason's heart leapt. The monastery was awake, and the chase that would define his fate was on. With the diadem secure in his grasp, he turned and fled the way he had come, his figure a shadow among shadows. The escape through the monastery was a blur of motion and adrenaline. Iason darted through lesser-known passages and secret doors, his knowledge of the monastery's layout a map in his mind. Behind him, the sound of pursuit grew, a cacophony of shouts and the heavy steps of the monks. Bursting from the monastery into the cool night air, Iason slipped into the labyrinth of Byzantium streets, the diadem a heavy weight in his possession. He moved through the city like a wraith, his path a circuitous route designed to confuse and lose his pursuers. The thief's journey had only just begun, with the streets of Byzantium a treacherous maze and the forces of the sacred and the profane aligning to reclaim what he had daringly stolen. Each shadow might shelter a threat. Each face in the crowd might mask a seeker of the cursed diadem, as Iason raced against destiny, the city's echoing alleys his first battleground. Chapter 2, Across the Mediterranean. With the diadem safely in his possession, and the alarm still echoing through the alleys of Byzantium, Iason knew he had to put as much distance as possible between himself and the monastery's furious pursuers. His heart pounding, he made his way to the bustling docks, where the salty air mixed with the cries of merchants and the creaking of moored ships. It was here, among the chaos of departing and arriving vessels, that Iason sought his passage from the city that was no longer safe for him. Disguised as a common merchant, Iason negotiated passage on a sturdy merchant ship bound for Marseille. The ship, laden with spices and silks, promised not just escape, but also the anonymity he desperately needed. As the coastline of Byzantium faded into the horizon, Iason felt a momentary relief, swiftly replaced by the weight of the journey ahead. The Mediterranean Sea was a realm of its own, governed by wind and wave, and frequented by those who sought fortune at any cost. Pirates roamed these waters, preying on the unwary. The ship's captain, a grizzled veteran of the sea lanes, eyed the diadem with suspicion, but said nothing, his attention fixed on navigating the treacherous waters. As the ship sailed across the open sea, Iason kept to himself, the diadem hidden within a false bottom in his trunk. But the relic's presence was not easily concealed. It seemed to hum with a strange energy, especially at night, when the stars blanketed the sky and the only sound was the lapping of the waves against the ship's hull. Iason began to notice a change in the crew's demeanor. Whispers filled the evening air, and tales of cursed treasure and haunted seas began to circulate among the men. Mid-voyage, as if drawn by the diadem's cursed call, a violent storm swept across the Mediterranean. Massive waves crashed against the ship, threatening to break it apart, while howling winds tore at the sails. The crew fought desperately to keep their vessel afloat, their faces etched with fear and exhaustion. Amidst the chaos, Iason clutched the diadem, feeling its power surge as if feeding off the storm's fury. Whispering into the gale, he promised anything for safe passage, a vow cast into the wind, heard by whatever gods or spirits presided over these cursed waters. Miraculously, as dawn broke, the storm abated. The sea calmed as quickly as it had raged, leaving the ship battered but still seaworthy. The crew, weary and wary, eyed Iason with a new respect mixed with fear. They spoke little of the night's events, superstitiously touching talismans and muttering prayers. The captain, a look of deep concern etched into his weathered face, navigated the ship with even greater caution, eager to rid himself of the passenger who had brought the wrath of the sea upon them. As the coast of Marseille finally came into view, Iason prepared to disembark, his thoughts a tangle of relief and apprehension. The diadem had proven its power and its curse, and he knew that his journey was far from over. The city of Marseille, with its bustling port and labyrinthine streets, offered new dangers and opportunities. Iason stepped off the ship with the diadem concealed and his senses alert, ready to delve into the underworld of a new city, where he would seek allies and information for the next leg of his perilous journey. Behind him, the ship's captain watched him go, a silent prayer on his lips that the sea would be kinder with the cursed relic now gone from his vessel. As Iason disappeared into the crowd, the Mediterranean sun cast long shadows on the docks, hinting at the dark and winding path that lay ahead. Chapter 3: A Stranger in France. Upon setting foot on the bustling docks of Marseille, Iason blended into the throng of merchants, sailors, and vagabonds that crowded the busy port. His heart was still thrumming from the journey across the sea, each wave a testament to the diadem's ominous power. Marseille, a melting pot of cultures and mysteries, offered both sanctuary and danger in equal measure. Here, Iason knew, the streets teemed not just with trade and commerce, but with secrets whispered in shadowy corners. Iason moved with cautious purpose, his senses sharp to the undercurrents of the city. Marseille was a labyrinth of narrow alleys and broad marketplaces, where the air was thick with the scent of spices and the salty tang of the sea. He needed to find a safe haven, a place to regroup and plan his next move. The underworld of Marseille was a network as complex and dangerous as any imperial court, and Iason was well aware that a man in his position, a stranger with a target on his back, could not afford to let down his guard. Through discreet inquiries and carefully measured conversations, Iason made contact with a local smuggler, known for his discretion and knowledge of the more arcane aspects of the city. In a dimly lit tavern, hidden away from the prying eyes of the gendarmerie, they met. The smuggler, a grizzled man with keen eyes, listened intently as Iason shared the barest details of his plight. "The diadem you carry," the smuggler murmured after a pause. "It's not just a relic, it's a beacon. And beacons attract all manner of attention, not all of it friendly." He offered Iason a place to stay, a secluded garret in one of the older quarters of the city, where the walls were thick and the neighbors' questions were few. As days turned into weeks, Iason delved deeper into the fabric of Marseille. He roamed the Vieux-Port at dawn, watched the fishmongers and sailors go about their business, and explored the ancient fortifications that spoke of the city's storied past. Each foray brought him closer to understanding the intricate web of power and peril that he had stepped into. One evening, under the cloak of a new moon, Iason followed the smuggler to the catacombs beneath the city. Here, the true underbelly of Marseille was revealed, a shadowy realm where the past and present collided, where secret societies met in chambers lined with skulls, and where the echoes of the dead mingled with the conspiracies of the living. "The diadem," the smuggler said, gesturing to the relic now hidden beneath Iason's cloak. "It belongs to an older world, one that doesn't forget easily." He introduced Iason to a cabal of scholars and mystics who specialized in the arcane. They pored over ancient manuscripts and debated the significance of the diadem, suggesting that it could unlock or lock away powers that were meant to be forgotten. Through these clandestine meetings, Iason learned of a ritual, one that could potentially neutralize the diadem's curse. But it required components that were as rare as they were dangerous to procure. With each piece of the puzzle revealed, Iason's path grew more perilous, leading him into the murky depths of the black market and through the velvet-lined salons of the city's occult patrons. As his quest evolved, so too did the dangers. Eyes followed him through the markets. Whispers reached his ears, speaking of a bounty on his head and the dark interest of those who served even darker masters. Iason realized that in Marseille, much like in Byzantium, the line between friend and foe was as thin as a whisper. And as he planned his next steps, he knew he must tread carefully, for each decision could lead either to salvation or to doom. In the tangled streets and shadowed crypts of Marseille, Iason found himself at the heart of a mystery that stretched far beyond the shores of France, into the realms of ancient legends and the wars of forgotten gods. And at the center of it all, the diadem pulsed with an ominous life of its own, a dark star guiding him further into the labyrinth of his own fate. Chapter 4, The Norse Revelation. Upon leaving the mysterious underbelly of Marseille, Iason headed north, his journey guided by the cryptic advice and ancient maps provided by the mystics he had consulted. The diadem, ever restless and whispering secrets of a forgotten age, seemed to resonate more intensely as he ventured into colder climates. The rugged landscapes of Scandinavia awaited him, where the mountains met the sea and ancient spirits roamed the misty fjords. Upon arriving in Norway, Iason felt a palpable shift in the air. The chilling winds carried echoes of Norse sagas, speaking of gods and monsters intertwined with the fate of the world. He traveled deep into the country, through dense forests where the trees stood tall like the masts of Viking ships, and up steep cliffs that offered views of the sprawling, icy waters below. His destination was a secluded valley rumored to house the entrance to a cave system known only to a few. According to the lore shared by a wary old seer in Marseille, this cave was where the serpent Jörmungandr, the Midgard serpent, had once been seen in the world of men, its body encircling the earth, biting its own tail. The legend suggested that the diadem was crafted from scales shed by this colossal beast during the ancient battles with the Norse gods. Finding the cave was no easy task. The locals spoke little to strangers, especially those who came asking after old myths and darker legends. Yet, Iason's journey had taught him how to listen to the silence and watch the unspoken words hanging in the cold air. With perseverance, he traced the steps of old Viking paths, marked by runes long eroded by wind and rain. As he approached the entrance to the cave, hidden behind a waterfall that froze into a curtain of ice in the winter light, Iason felt the diadem stir. It was as if the ancient relic recognized its homeland, pulsing with a cold fire that matched the icy landscape. Stepping behind the waterfall, Iason found the cave opening, guarded by statues of Norse warriors, their stone eyes watching over a threshold few were meant to cross. Inside, the cave plunged into the depths of the earth, winding through passages lined with ice that glimmered with an ethereal glow. The deeper Iason ventured, the stronger the diadem's response, until he reached a vast cavern where the air thrummed with power. In the center of this cavern stood a stone altar carved with images of Jörmungandr, its form looping around the edges in an endless cycle of consuming its own tail. It was here, the seer had claimed, that the diadem needed to be returned. But as Iason approached the altar, the shadows around him stirred. Figures emerged, cloaked in the vestiges of ancient Norse warriors, their eyes burning with the light of the aurora that danced above the surface far overhead. They were the keepers of the serpent, descendants of those who had once worshipped Jörmungandr as a god of the underworld. The keepers spoke in a tongue that was old when the world was young, their words heavy with the weight of eons. They explained that the diadem was not merely a relic of power, but a key, one that could awaken Jörmungandr from its slumber, triggering the cataclysm of Ragnarok, the end of all things. Faced with the gravity of his quest, Iason was given a choice. He could leave the diadem on the altar, trusting the keepers to guard it as they had for centuries, or he could attempt to destroy it, risking untold consequences. The decision weighed heavily on him as he stood in the cavern, the fate of the world hanging in the balance. As the northern lights flickered above, casting their eerie light into the depths of the earth, Iason placed the diadem on the altar. A deep, resonant sound filled the cavern, like the earth itself breathing a sigh of relief, or perhaps resignation. The keepers nodded in approval, their forms fading back into the shadows, leaving Iason alone with the weight of his choices and the silent, watchful gaze of the serpent carved in stone.